Hi, I'm Whitney Espick, the CEO of the MIT Alumni Association, and I hope you enjoy this digital production created for alumni and friends like you.
Hi, everyone, and thank you for joining us today for our virtual tour of MIT's Minecraft campus. My name is Johanna Keough. I'm the Associate Director of Class Programs at the MIT Alumni Association, and I'm joined here today by three of our student moderators of the MIT Minecraft campus who will be telling us about this very cool project and giving us a tour. We want to make today as interactive as possible, so please use the Q&A box for any comments and questions directed at our student moderators. During the guided tour of the MIT Minecraft campus, you can also request specific sites you'd like to see during the tour. So let me start things off by introducing our panelists today. We'll start with Shayna Ahteck. She is a freshman and a student moderator of this project. Shayna will also be our excellent tour guide today. Next, we have Billy Moses, and he is an alum from the class of 2018, and he's a current PhD student here at MIT. He's also the chair of the Student Information Processing Board, which houses this project. And last, we have Jeffery Yu. He's a student from the class of 2022 and also a student moderator of this project. So to kick things off, panelists, I'm going to hand it over to you and we can go one by one. Please introduce yourselves, give a bit of background about you and your involvement in this project. Shayna, do you want to kick us off?
Hi. Thank you for the lovely introduction, Joanna. So I'm Shayna Ahteck. I am a class of 2023 student. I am majoring in course 2A. I got involved with the project from a very close point at its start. I had actually never played Minecraft before this project launched, and like I just sort of jumped onto it because I thought it was a really cool idea, and I was processing my own feelings about having my freshman year cut short essentially by leaving campus so soon and so suddenly, as well as like a deep appreciation for the culture that I was, the culture of MIT that I was so quickly wrapped up into. I've been working on the project, helping a lot with outreach, publicity, and a little bit of server maintenance too. So it's been fun.
Thank you. And we can turn things over to Billy now.
Hi, everyone. I'm Billy Moses, a class of 2018, current PhD student in Course 6. My involvement with the project has largely been on the technical side. So specifically, that's setting up the Minecraft server on the bigger, beefier machine, doing a bunch of backups, adding some voice chat integration, and a lot of other fun things like that that allow all of the worlds to come together, as well as trying to help get students access to Minecraft by going and asking the quest for intelligence and bulk purchase of licenses and likes of that. Also, a super duper quick thing. So Minecraft is a sort of block playing video game, sort of like digital Legos in some sense, that lets you recreate a bunch of really interesting things. And in this case, we managed to collectively with about, I think it's like 200 or 300 current builders, with many more who've actually went and visited the project, built a huge swath of campus, which is fairly exciting.
Thank you, Billy. And last, Jeffery, will you please introduce yourself and give a little bit of background on your involvement in this project?
Right. So, hi, everyone. My name is Jeffery. I'm a class of 22, courses 18 and 8. For those of you asking, as well as someone asking, this is a view from the top of the Prudential Center in Boston. So you see Charles River, and then across from that would be MIT campus. I was initially one of the, first founders of this project. When we first started, we actually started on a much smaller scale server that I ran on one of my personal desktops. And within a week and a half, it grew by a lot to the point where it made sense to move it off of my computer onto one of Sitbeat's servers. And then from there, the project just kept on expanding. I'm mostly, over the past month, I haven't been as involved, but when I do stuff, it's mostly also on the server side, similar to Billy.
Thank you. So for everyone attending today, please be sure to use the Q&A box. If you think of questions for the panelists, please type them in there. We will have time for Q&A both during this moderated session as well as during the tour. So to keep the conversation going until we move into Q&A, I'm hoping all the panelists can tell me about their favorite site on the Minecraft map or their favorite project that they worked on for this project. Do you want to?
I guess I can go ahead and get started.
Thank you.
What was it? The first structure that I built in the MIT Minecraft campus when I was still getting used to Minecraft as like a whole like digital Lego style medium was my dorm, McCormick Hall. I just felt that like from like the general sort of vibe of my dorm, there weren't that many people that were interested in Minecraft as a medium, and I thought it was really important to have one of my spaces that I frequently visit on campus to be represented, especially my floor, 7 West. So I prioritized building the Towers of McCormick, a lot of the first floor, and I installed an elevator platform system in there that I'm actually kind of proud of.
Awesome, thank you. Billy, how about you?
Sure. So the places that I really like on campus are those that sort of I have like an emotional tie to. As an example, for instance, the SIPI office, which is the club that houses this, has a bunch of really cute things, including some of the computer related things hanging from the ceiling. There's an Easter egg of the server inside of the server room that's running this. Similarly, in the AeroAstro lab, there's like a recreation of Dave, the engineer there, who helps everyone with the various things, which I think are my personal favorite things because it sort of shows that what was built on campus are the things that people really care about and what makes a difference in their lives. I'm also personally really impressed by Stata, which unfortunately is one of the slower going buildings. So we have this plugin called WorldEdit that lets you basically copy and paste large swaths of blocks. So you can say, make the green building really quickly and easily by copy and pasting the floors. Stata, however, by virtue of its design going everywhere, is kind of slow going. So I'm really continuing to be impressed by it coming up and all of the curves and interesting things of it slowly existing.
Thank you. And how about you, Jeffery?
Right. So I think one of the first things that I built was working with several other people. One of the first buildings we made was Lobby 7. It was, I think, one of the buildings we started off by kicking off. And it was pretty challenging, especially by like limits. The sort of rectangular parts were easy, but then obviously the dome was a challenge, as well as some of the interior designs. I think even though I haven't been building as much anymore, I think I'm always impressed by how MIT's engineering spirit shows through how people approach these buildings, especially with some of the trickier parts. Minecraft has this thing called redstone, which is somewhat analogous to basically electrical circuit wiring in a way. And people have used that to build many impressive things. I know Shayna mentioned that they built an basically functional elevator with it. Someone managed to build a revolving door type structure for the green building. So those have been very impressive. Another thing that I've been very impressed by have been the murals. So MIT blocks, if we're doing it to scale, each block is like 1 meter by 1 meter by 1 meter. So if you want to like build a detailed painting, a single block doesn't really do it justice. So people have found ways around that, which is namely by building a much larger version of whatever painting you want in some faraway land and then creating a map of that land. And when you look at the map, you actually see the finer details of a painting or mural or whatever you want to make. So that's also been very impressive.
Thank you. And one last thing that I want to touch upon before we move into Q&A for this section. Something that really touched me when we were doing our planning for this and meeting about what we would talk about on this event was the motivation behind this. Given that, I mean, Jeffrey's background is fooling us a little bit, but none of you are on campus right now. You're all at home. So when you're in the Minecraft campus and you're building and you're looking at MIT at scale, how do you feel? What does this project mean to you right now at this time?
So personally, like I remember the first couple times, and still this continues to happen every time that I log in, just looking around immediately, it's really surreal. just being able to see and interact with the campus, because you know that you're definitely not there, and you look around, and obviously this is a somewhat cartoonized version of it, but as you can walk around and see all of these places that you recognize and you used to spend most of your time at, it feels in some sense like you're back there. Obviously there's an understanding that this is a cartoonized version where everything is not the same, but to be able to see and interact, be like, oh, here's the stud where I used to spend all this time walking to my class. It's an interesting feeling, to say the least.
Yeah. I think personally, like, this project, its existence and the way that it's popped up and created and been contributed to by so many people has been a testament to, like, the passion of the MIT community and, like, our own communities that we do form on campus related to the spaces that we occupy in various dorms and academic buildings and other, like, buildings on campus. There are a few frats and sororities that have shown up to have their spaces represented on campus ever since that we started this, basically the week that we left home, that we left MIT and most of us returned home, around like early-ish March. It's also been like a really unique historical artifact of this specific moment in time, which feels like a pause, that people can create campus right now as we saw it in this present moment, which opens up the possibility for using this medium to recreate MIT as it was seen in various points of history. For example, resurrecting dorms that may have been gone now, various structures and buildings that have since been replaced with MIT's ever-evolving landscape, and ultimately possibly creating the campus we want to see.
For me, it's a combination of like a bittersweet and nostalgic feeling in various parts. So I guess certain things, if you just look at it from the outside, it's really nice to be able to take the whole view in, sort of stuff you see on a day-to-day basis. And then in particular, stuff that I guess hit me personally would be some of the finer details people put into things, because obviously you can look at pictures of MIT on the web or all sorts of things. And that's partly what some people have used to recreate them, a combination of, I guess, Google Street View and floor plans, but a lot of it also comes from people's memories directly of the details of how space is laid out or sort of the interior design. When I get to see these interior design stuff, all the tiny details that people have put into it, it really makes me feel like this is a sort of much more, I guess, personal recreation of what has been my home.
Thank you. So I see lots of comments coming through right now. To answer a few quick questions, we're going to do some Q&A in this format of a panel, and then we will move into the tour. So we'll just do a few quick questions here. Shayna, you touched upon this, but can you tell us exactly when this project began and will it continue to be ongoing?
March 10th was the infamous day, which we all got the notice that in order to de-densify campus, most undergraduates should move off of campus. And in the following week, it was like a whole like mass move out panic, lots of things. Definitely a time in history. And then following that, in the week that we were, for the most part, the majority of us, either like self-isolating at home or like in campus on sort of people who have requested extensions to stay on campus because they were international students or had outstanding circumstances or the like. In that time that we were sitting around and a lot of us were congregating on this Discord server that was like an instant messaging sort of server that had been set up for a lot of the MIT community to connect while in exile, quote unquote. We generally like had a little bit of a consensus of hey, wouldn't it be cool if we did some sort of massively multiplayer online type project in order to engage a lot of the community, as well as have something to show to the pre-frosh for CPEW or CP Star as it was for like the last little event month kind of thing that we had, which was generally agreed upon by a lot of people, and Jeffery got the ball rolling with the first server, as well as like another student, I think Alex Patton, initially getting all the like plots down from a PNG of the map and a world painter tool. And And from there, it was just people that were coming in, flocking to the project. I helped connect a lot of people to being able to be on the server and like learning how to function in it and contribute their parts to it. And it was great.
Thank you. Another question that just came in, and Billy, I know you will touch upon this after the tour, but we can allude to it now. I know this is a very meaningful project for a lot of our alumni, and they're excited to get in and help build and look around. So we have a question. Someone is wanting to know if the link to go in person will be available after this.
Yeah, so we're going to share two links, and I can, in fact, put two of them in the chat really quickly. The first link is to a website with a couple of cute little pieces of information. If you happen to still have your MIT certificates, you can click and it'll give you the info on how to connect. If you don't have your MIT certificates, the correct place to connect to is inside of Minecraft. You do direct connect to a server or add server, and the one that you should do is minecraft-tours.mit.edu, and that'll bring you into a read copy of the world where you can go and explore, which we'll be joining shortly.
Thank you. And let's do one more question, and then we can get started in the tour, and we can continue the conversation while we're in there. Shayna will be giving the tour, but both of our other student moderators will be available to help answer questions, and it'll be very interactive and conversation-based. So this question, first, it starts with, excellent job, everyone. This is great. They can't wait to explore. The question is, how do you maintain sufficient dimensional accuracy? Did you get blueprints of the campus with dimension as a starting point? How did you do this?
So there's a bunch of floor plans available on MIT's website, as well as the overview from Google Maps and the like that we were able to import the static image of. So starting with these two things as a baseline, we have a rough idea of where all the various buildings are, and then we can sort of attempt to place all the things on the inside. Not everything quite fits because you have to make some approximations when everything's rounded to a meter by a meter block, and people have different decisions in terms of both how the colors should work with the Minecraft blocks and how the various like stairs and everything should go out. But for the most part, we've managed to reach consensus by using a channel inside of our Discord chat where everyone sends in their favorite images of campuses. I think it should probably be like this, and then collectively deciding this block type or location works nicely.
Thank you. Okay, Shayna, why don't we begin with you sharing your screen and walking us through the campus. We already have a few requests for places people would like to see, the first being McGregor Hall, Suite G. I don't know if it gets that specific. I can't wait to see. Also, McCormick Hall, 10250 and 36100.
What is it? Joanna, do you think you could turn on screen sharing for me? Because it says the host has disabled participant screen sharing.
You should be all set now.
There we go.
Great. Sorry about that, Shayna. A comment that just came through, it makes me so happy that Sippy is still around. So much about MIT has changed since the 80s, but not that.
All right, can everybody see me?
We can.
Awesome. So welcome to the Minecraft Institute of Technology. so we're out here at the MassApp crosswalk, which is the spawn point on the map, looking into Lobby 7 and a lot of West Campus, including the stud and dorm row, which will be captured on the way back. But I think first we're gonna head through Lobby 7 and Lobby 10, some of the more iconic points of MIT so far. Let's see. So you might notice upon entering that there are these like dispenser structures on top that are meant to represent these Purell dispensers, which were an artifact of our very recent time on campus, in which there were a lot of these Purell dispensers that were deployed on campus. So it's been a bit of a joke among students to implement this, but yeah, here's the inside of Lobby 7 with the skylight and the underside of the little dome. The various balconies and banners and the like represented. So as we go along the infinite corridor, this is an example of one of the murals that we mentioned before. Someone had created the the seal that is present in Lobby 7 in a corner of the map and created like a sort of map representation of it that was able to be placed on some block. There's been people that have been taking like screenshots and photos of themselves with it, replicating a little bit of the tourism that goes along with this. No, usually with visits of campus. So yeah, going down the infinite corridor. There's still a lot of the usual large amounts of notice boards and murals that have not yet been included, but are in the process of being included. Various offices that are also along the infinite that have been represented in floor plan style. There's the admissions office.
Yeah, PD spent a lot of time, if memory serves, putting little Easter eggs inside of the admissions office. PD is one of the admissions officers.
We had a question that came in. Do you each have a favorite Easter egg on campus?
Oh yeah, you can't hit person to first. You have to share your
screen. So my personal favorite is that there's a representation of the server that runs this inside of the server room itself, which I think is very cute.
Right now I'm just heading through building 10 and we're going up into 10 to 50, I guess, while Jeffery keeps talking.
Sure. Yeah. One of the original Easter eggs was I don't know if this was the case back in the days, but nowadays, if you walk into Lobby 7, the doors open rather slowly, and a lot of times you have to like slow down your pace of walk to get in. And so when we originally made the doors for Lobby 7, we included a little bit of redstone contraption to potentially make that delay. So if you're walking at a normal pace, you'll hit the door before it opens. Unfortunately, that part, I think that had to be sort of removed to make room for the tunnels. But I might look into a way to sort of find a different place to get that wiring back in.
Thank you. You're having a lot of great comments come in. People are saying this is the best thing ever. So cool. A question that just came in twice, so I want to make sure we get to it. I think it's a good one. Is there a way to walk on the campus with other people so you feel like you're on campus, or are you by yourself when you're viewing?
Yeah, so when you connect to the server, you need two different Minecraft accounts and two people connecting, sort of like how Shayna has the person along with them right now. Those be a virtual representation of yourself in the world that you can interact and walk around with. There's also some other helper commands that you can do if you don't know where the other person is, like you can teleport to where they are right away and then suddenly appear, which is useful.
So we also have the Barker Engineering Library reading room represented, which was a really nice little feature on the underside of the dome. As we were actually constructing the dome, it was me and Alex Patton, another one of the moderators, that were actually putting this up the night before that we were working with MIT News to create a video for the news website, which was pretty neat. We were actually referencing a lot of the the blueprint printing screens that are on display in between the printing plates, on display in between the actual Lobby 7 and Lobby 13 that I had taken pictures of during my CPW, which was super cool to see. I think the architects are probably rolling in their graves thinking that their plans would be used for a digital representation in this way. Hey, it's been really cool for accuracy and like also like a little bit of a historical appreciation of all the effort that went into building and designing campus.
Thank you. And a few things that have come through the chat I just want to touch upon. Someone just said this would be fun to have as a Zoom background, and we have some images of the Minecraft campus available as Zoom backgrounds. Check out the techreunions.mit.edu website for those. And another fun comment is, this is far superior to the MIT sandcastles we made on dorm beach trips on Cape Cod. So keep up the great work. A question that came in, did you use any texture packs, mods, or plugins other than Word Edit?
So right now we're running without any specific texture packs, though we, related to texture pack, also have a couple of the really nice images were taken with particular different lighting effects, which make it really nice. The other plugins that we've used just to make life a lot easier include ones that allow you to, say, teleport to particular locations on campus, so then you don't have to necessarily walk all the way from Simmons to wherever you want to go, which is quite useful. The other plugins that we added were related to a couple of other specific maintenance or other fun tasks, like one for doing proximity aware voice chat. So if you're close to someone inside of the Minecraft world, you can talk and talk to whoever's closest to you, which is cute. Some other ones for like backup protection, as well as like seeing who built what, which is particularly useful. Another thing that I saw, which someone asked, which is really useful, is so we've had so far about 1,000 different people who have entered the various servers that we've had. We've spent a collective 92 person days inside building or exploring, which is incredibly cute. We actually happen to run a lot of different individual worlds. So we have the main MIT world where people are building things. We have one specific for tours. We have one specific for games and other stuff like that. As an example, over CPW, which is the campus preview weekend where a lot of the prospective students go and tour and do various things for campus, a particular fraternity went through and played a capture the flag game on the MIT map, which is really nice. But obviously, if you're having things that go and destroy and blow up things, you want to keep the main map secure and not blown up. So that's why we run various versions. I also saw that someone commented that, unfortunately, Bexley isn't on there, and a goal is to be able to have multiple copies of the map, because we run multiple servers for these sort of things, say one per different era, so we might be able to have a version where like Bexley and those sort of things are there, maybe one like the 1900s, where like MIT had just moved. So also, if you're interested in helping build any of these sort of things, you should email on icecream-machine.mit.edu to the sippy-minecraft or sippy-minecraft.root, and we'll go give you access and permission to go build on the builder map. The URL that we gave earlier, which is minecraft-tours.mit.edu, is a read-only world, and you should just put that inside of the server connect, which I'll show you at the end of the day, since I saw someone asked what happens when you go to that URL.
Thank you. So the easiest way for people to access this and get in touch with you all is the SIPI website?
Or the icecream-machine.mit.edu will be a website with a bunch of the pieces of information, which if you email the email on there, we will give you all of the things that you need.
Okay.
It's currently certificate protected because at one point we had some people outside of MIT who tried getting access to the information and going destroying things, hence all of the backups that were added. But we're more than happy to share all the details to the alums.
So yeah, I just wanted to say that we've been looking at Lobby 10 and the Dome for like the last little while. One of the cool things that happened on the server was actually when we put the initial dome up, within a couple of hours of the dome being up, someone installed the police car hack on top of the dome, which stays there to today. What is it? There haven't been like a lot of examples of hacks in Minecraft MIT because it's a little bit harder for the medium. But actually, the Burton Third Bombers, through their annual DTYD party, also in Minecraft via the like digital porter room, and we managed to get some music working for them, and they built a plane in the space above Lobby 10, which was pretty neat to see.
So I know we have a lot of interest in seeing dorms on the chat. And another question I think could be useful if we addressed, someone asked if they had to buy and install Minecraft or if it's a website, how exactly you get to Minecraft.
So Minecraft is a video game that's run by Mojang, now owned by Microsoft. In order to join, you do need a copy of the game. For current students, we actually managed to work with ISNT and the likes and procure a bunch of licenses for students to be able to use. It's about $30 or so. You can buy it from Amazon to get a digital code or Best Buy or wherever you want. Once you have the game specifically should be the Java edition of the game rather than the like Windows version or the other edition, because that allows for the mods that we use, then you should be able to direct connect. And it's all good. So it's not quite a website. It's kind of like a video game. And then you connect to a server that hosts all the fun things.
Thank you.
Also, just want to point out, I really like the tiles inside of the physics building 6C. They're really pretty.
Bars of color. Yeah, yes. We've actually had a decent amount of campus art being represented in block form, which I thought was cool to see pop up. Yeah, what is it? I think there's also Trinity that's represented on the way to Building 26, as we're headed towards now. Yep, right there.
There has been a special request to also see the inside of Kresge. And we have another question. What is the scale of the campus?
Sure. So yep. It's a one-to-one map, which means like 1 meter in real life corresponds to 1 meter blocks inside of here. The campus is actually fairly well built. It spans, let me open the overview map just to make sure I get the entirety of it right. It spans at one end, you've got, I forgot the name of the bridge that's like not quite the Museum of Science, but relatively close to there with the buildings at the other side of campus, all the way to Tang. It's mostly the Cambridge side of campus where all of those things seem to be decently built there. Though we do have a couple of things on the Boston side, like someone decided to go and build the Prudential Center, or there's a fraternity or two. There's also cute things inside the river as well, like the sailing pavilion exists, or like the crew boathouse and so on.
Oh, also, I just wanted to note for someone who's having connectivity issues in the questions that minecraft-tours.mit.edu is the IP address that you would enter when connecting to another server in the copy of Minecraft the game. So far, we have not built up a visitor's website there yet, but that's within the plans.
Yeah. If you want to go to something inside of your browser, you should go to the ice cream dash machine, and it'll have the nice little overview map and links. But yes, inside of the server, you've got a...
Yes, so right now we're looking at building 32, the Stata or Stata, depending on how you depends it, depending on how you pronounce it, building, which replaced building 20 way back in the day. Yeah, it's currently very much incomplete because of the architecture that we are still figuring out how to work in a lot of the angles. It's definitely a challenge, and most of us are not architecture majors or researchers in that regard. But yeah, as this building holds like a lot of importance to especially a lot of course 6 students and CSL researchers and the like, we're working on getting it represented.
How long does it take you to build a building on Minecraft like this data center?
It really depends on the building. Like Stata Center, I'm going to just put it an indeterminate amount of time. For other buildings, like the green building that the chain is going to, where there's some more regular pattern, it's a lot easier because you could lay out a certain amount of blocks and then say copy and paste the floors. So once you've done one part of it that's reasonable, you can easily get the rest of it up fairly quickly. What's also really nice, which like these buildings always continue to evolve. In some sense, it's like a piece of writing or a piece of code or something. It always grows, and then people add other cute additional items to it. Like you can see, like the roof of the green building has been added, or the inside of dorms where people put beds in all of the rooms or particular things that are meaningful to them. The green building cannot currently play Tetris, but we are looking into using redstone to be able to do so. So theoretically, it can and will in the near future, but not quite.
Also, it's been neat to just kind of see the roof of the green building when it's usually not very accessible to most people outside of sketchy hours. Yeah, we also included the pumpkins up here as a little tribute to the green building pumpkin drop. So one person could theoretically just pick a pumpkin and drop it off.
This is so cool. Lots of comments are coming through about how accurate the details are and what a great job you all did. A question is, are FSILGs added to this model?
Yeah, so this model is open to whoever wants to build whatever they like inside of the world. So there have been plenty of FSILGs who have built themselves. In particular, there's different versions that have been built. So the particular version of the world, as we said, is this one-to-one map. There have also been a couple of FSILGs, like Pika, that have built like a much larger version of themselves, as well as Next House, to be able to show a lot more of the intricate details that we might have a warp to the bigger version from the smaller version of it. Yeah, so it's basically whatever students feel like that they want to build, they're more than welcome to build in the various places. It's not limited to particular places on campus.
Thank you. And we have a question. Why are there pandas on the roof?
As this tour is as this server and like all the entire like Minecraft project is contributed to by the entire MIT community, there are a lot of very fun things that find their way in, not just Easter eggs, but people learning that you can spawn various animals. I personally enabled animal spawning just because I wanted to see bunnies hopping across campus, as they tend to be one of the I guess more noted parts of walking around campus. Like there's a whole Facebook page dedicated towards the bunnies of MIT and various sightings. And personally, I've run across several of them while walking around at night on campus, so it felt important to my experience to see them represented. Also, senior house! Yeah, we had an alum from the class of 2012? 2010, I want to say? Contact us with regards to help on recreating senior house, because the building still stands as it is in current campus, so there's a bit of a sport death flag. And some various murals on the inside that we are working on recreating from photos that were taken before it was not senior house. And so there's also the Media Lab and List Art Center that are recreated on this side of campus.
We've had a few people write in the Q&A box wondering how similar Minecraft is to Second Life. Would anyone be able to answer that?
So I haven't personally played Second Life, though I'm aware of a couple of the things. I think a big difference between Minecraft and Second Life is that it's designed to be a lot more for creative purposes and like hackable and building sort of sense. Second Life, I think, is a little bit harder to do so, just because like the culture behind Minecraft, everyone created plugins. It was originally inside of Java, where it was also used as a way to learn how to code in a bunch of places like that. The specifics of the structures in that way, I'm not as familiar with. If Shayna or Jeffery, you have more.
Second Life.
Yeah, I'd say that like Second Life tends to revolve a lot more around like MMORPG style interactions, in which like there's like various players that are interacting with each other with like little chat bubbles above their like avatar figures and everything. Whereas Minecraft seems to be focused around like the structures themselves. Like, in order to aid that, we have created things like proximity-based voice chat. We do use the chat function a lot as well. And there are like various chat and voice channels that are available on our Discord server that people have used while they're building things and they just want to communicate with other people or while they're visiting. We've gotten notice there's like people from various living groups that have gone on calls together and explored campus and chatted with each other in that way as a way to connect. But yeah, we're also popping by the sailing pavilion, of which there are this one and the one closer to dorm row that have been faithfully recreated. I find really cool with all the various shells.
I noticed a lot of people asking, yes, you need to get the Java edition for this. Try not to get the Pocket edition or the Windows edition or any of the other editions.
You don't need to install Java or anything. You just need to download the Minecraft Java edition, and it'll take care of the installation.
So we have lots of questions about the details of the campus, whether certain things are represented. So someone is wondering how well the tunnels are represented. There's a few questions about the Muddy Charles.
Yes, so back where Trina was earlier, the Muddy Charles is in fact represented in the inside of Walker, which is really nice. A common place for many grad students to go after a long day's work.
And how about the tunnels?
The tunnels are, I think, pretty much still a work in progress.
Okay.
They're very much planned to be represented, but I'm not sure that a lot of it is there yet.
So, like, the negative infinite does exist in part, as well as a couple of other places, but it doesn't necessarily take you to everywhere that you would want to go inside of the tunnels, but hopefully soon.
So yeah, we have maps of campus, including the one that's usually near the Alchemist. Oops. Looks like somebody shot the map. We'll replace that later. and a larger version of the map that is in the alley by Massey Hall, of which also probably needs to be replaced. See, the way that like maps exist are as entities in the world, so we've had issues with them sometimes going missing if someone errantly punches them, and we have backups that are stored, which will be restored. So yeah. There's the stud, the student center. We've gotten comments that this actually looks better in Minecraft than it does in real life, of which the blocky architecture really does contribute. Yeah, and this is Kresge. So Kresge was actually the first building to go up on campus that was created, partially due to the curved roof. So walking into Kresge, this is how it is represented.
other cute thing that I'm going to comment is immediately when MIT told everyone that they needed to leave campus, there was a hack done on top of Kresge in which there was a Purell dispenser put on top of it, since earlier there was Purell dispensers everywhere on campus, and that hack was quickly replicated in the Minecraft version of Kresge as well.
Alright, let me just down here, we can take a peek into Little Kresge as well.
And so Shayna is a campus tour guide, but given the state of the world, she's actually given more tours virtually than she's done in person, which I find so funny. So we have a few questions. It's been asked more than once. People want to know if you use orange tours within Minecraft.
So people can choose to give various types of tours. So orange tours are a sort of hacker-specific tour through MIT, and how people decide to use the world and display what interesting things about them is totally up to them, as often orange tours involve going to places on campus you aren't supposed to necessarily go to, and specific quirks of the campus that may not be publicly accessible. I'm not going to say too much more on it, but mm-hmm. if you wanted to go explore particular areas, there are representations of certain fun places inside of the Minecraft world as well.
I'm just saying it's much easier to go onto Minecraft roofs than it is in real roofs in real life. Not admitting to anything, but fun little extracurricular activities. So yeah, here's Massey Hall. So Massey was one of the dorms in which we could replicate like the floors up fairly easily. So there are a lot of rooms that are represented here with beds, tables, carpeting. Ooh, oops, somebody teleported me. That has been really neat to see. Let's see. Here's my dorm, McCormick Hall, that I created personally, that I'm really proud of seeing. I don't think we can go into the interior of many of the dorms like within time limits and everything, because this is just an hour, and you could spend honestly hours like just poking around campus. But flying by the windows, it's pretty neat. Baker is still in progress. I have a friend of mine from Baker who is going to be hopping on soon now that the finals and everything are over, in order to help build up its interior and exterior. And we have had ILGs represented. There's Pika to the north that we probably won't be covering here, but also Kappa Sigma that had their little purple guy on top. And Burton Connor. So there are still remnants of the DTYD decorations that the bombers had put up when they held their dance in it. We used the proximity-based voice chat feature in order to introduce like a music bot to them. So you could have like proximity-based music, and we're working on doing this linked to various artifacts in the world. So you stand by them, you can hear custom sounds or something like that, expanding the game in that way. DC still lives.
Do any of you know if other universities in the Cambridge, Boston area have done a similar virtual build like this? Someone is asking if a small liberal arts school up the river has.
So there's been many, many colleges and universities who have made Minecraft representations of themselves. Harvard actually hasn't really progressed as much, but one of the really big ones that has had a lot of progress is UC Berkeley's, and they've had a huge ritual ceremony concert inside there.
Yeah, I've actually taken the lead on contacting a lot of other college builds that have existed, in which we do have a Discord server with each other to sort of discuss building techniques, what we learn from managing large Minecraft servers, especially of school builds and the like. There does exist a consortium of the Ivy League schools plus MIT and Stanford that have gotten together to like talk about our various campuses and everything, as well as various other Boston area schools, including Boston University, I think Berkeley, that has their builds somewhat together. And we've been considering inviting some Harvard students to help create a server much, much, much to the north of MIT, and possibly merging all of our universities and campuses together to create a Boston area map, considering that there are a lot of MIT FSILGs that branch out into Boston itself that would overlap with other campuses, especially BU.
And can you change the interior lighting during a tour in Minecraft?
So the easiest way to change a lot of the lighting properties is through the use of client-side shaders, which you can use to make realistic-looking clouds or any of the things to be a lot brighter, use ray tracing or the likes of that. You can also change the interior lighting by adding light blocks or equivalent inside of there as well, which sort of depends how you want to see the look. And the server IP you want to connect to is minecraft-tours. Note that it's not a website, but you need to connect inside of Minecraft to go there.
So yeah, we're hanging around outside of Next House and Tang right now. This is just like a fun little feature of the server that is not actually present in real life, but someone created like this little small animal farm. And here is Simmons to the other side of campus, which is neat. We currently do not have New Vassar slash West Garage, as it is colloquially known, represented yet, due to it not necessarily being present on campus during our time, as still being in construction and all. So there are still a few empty plots that do exist of buildings that have not been yet created. And if you would like to help out, definitely give us an email later and we can help connect you to campus.
There's a lot of interest in the pandas and the roaming animals. People love them. They want to know if they're free to roam or if you're controlling them.
Oh yeah, they're absolutely free to roam. Actually, in the McCormick bike shed, I previously had a couple of horses, of which I would unleash one and go ride down up and down Dorm Row with it, because who hasn't wanted to do that at some point in their life? Yeah, but like most other animals that are not like saddled in the world are free to just roam around and hop around campus as long as like the chunk that they're in is loaded. Where are my bunnies? Oh, they sometimes get stuck on the stud stairs, but they've been around. Yeah, it's possible for users in the world to generate animals. Yeah, we've had Z Center. You can pop into the stud now and actually see the Zippy office.
And while we're navigating to that, a few different times people have asked in the Q&A box how this project actually began. Do you mind all just giving us a quick synopsis on how this idea came to be and how it got started?
So there was this large group chat inside, once everyone left campus, that was created in a platform medium called Discord, that once everyone's inside of there, all talking about the various things on a lot of different medium, people talk about and whether or not we should do a virtual recreation of campus. And quickly, it was created by Jeffery on top of the server that we built. And from there, it grew quite large and everyone sort of joined and connected. And now we have 1,000 people who all joined the server.
Yep. So we've had the Sippy office in its very interesting glory recreated on campus, a lot of Billy's domain. Yes, you may borrow the stapler.
And, yeah, so oh my God, context, Sippy, or the Student Information Processing Board, is the club that hosts the servers and the likes for this, which there's a lot of cute computer-related things. This door notoriously in real life does not open very well, hence we had to make sure to add as an Easter egg the fact that it does not really well work in this life. And yeah, over on the left there's like an allusion to the machine that runs the actual server itself, which is very cute.
So yeah, our server room. wait, how do I get out of here?
You have to go back around. There you go.
Wait, am I doing this right?
Yep, down there. And then there's a button on the left. Yeah.
Oops.
Two detailed questions.
Crowded server room now.
Navigating this. We have two detailed questions. Does the weather change? And is the Dunkin' Donuts in the student center?
So right now, the weather does not change. It's perpetually stuck at noon right now, but we can change that to particular events as see fit. The Dunkin' Donuts, I don't think, is currently built, but
no, the Dunkin' Donuts is there. Hold on, I'm just trying to figure out where's the way to get down again.
Yeah, the if you fall down the elevator shaft.
Is it this one?
Yeah. Yes. Yeah.
All right, that's the basement. That's too far. I know that the stud Dunkin' Donuts was an important place for a lot of people. So I think it was constructed this way. Yep. Ta-da! And little brewing stands to, I guess, represent coffee in the life. Who put the dolphin here? what is it? Another notable thing in the set is that Anna's tahiera was also recreated in a surprising amount of detail. And we'll go in and clean up those animals later.
In a surprising but necessary amount of detail.
Indeed.
Well, we have less than 10 minutes left, so I want to make sure that Shayna and Billy and Jeffery, if there's anything super cool that you really think we should see during this tour, if nothing else, I want to make sure we get to that. So I leave the next decisions as to what we see up to you all.
Let's see. Have there been any requests in the Q&A that I haven't been looking over too much?
The inside of Kresge, the skating rink.
Oh yeah, we should go through the Zoo Center since you're
close
there.
Let's go to the Zoo Center.
Building 24 and the reactor. There's a lot.
Yeah. SIDPAC does exist, in part built by Greg and a little bit myself, since I saw someone ask about grad dorms. Some of the others less so, but still there. The boathouse also does exist, and it's really nice.
I can't explain the llamas here. That's
that is the one cute thing about the world. You appear somewhere and suddenly new things have happened. Sometimes they're like, oh my god, a new building there. Sometimes it's llamas.
Sometimes it's llamas. yeah, so hopping around here. Rockwell cage and a lot of the basketball courts that do exist here. There was also the pool.
Also the pool. Hold on. Yeah.
I'm not really sure how I get around there.
I think you go through
that. Oh, whatever. It works though here.
Yeah.
So yeah, it's in the pool here. People have actually put like boats across here, which I think was a really fun tribute to the head of the Z-Sigger event that used to happen back in the day, I think. Yeah, racing student-built boats across the pool, also where we take the swim test, graduation requirements, yeah. What's this? I think another thing that was on this side or some side was, oh yeah, I think the martial arts, one of the organizations created one of their practice spaces back here. So while like the entire structure isn't complete, as you can see by around here, they do have like a lot of like stands and dummies with their gear and things.
And what are the next big things that you're all planning on building? What's next on the horizon?
I think trying to get Stata up is for me at least one of the things. As also mentioned, a lot of the grad dorms are now starting to pop up as some of the grad students join in the participation of the things, which is very exciting. I think the other big things from my perspective is just adding a lot of like cute details to the places. Like actually, Shayna, would you mind going over to the Aero Astro area? You can show like the machine
I'm heading
room
up there right now.
And Dave and the likes. Yeah. So I think adding in the sort of details that really make these spaces personal to everybody is the big thing that I think is really nice and people are continuing to add as time goes on.
Where should I be going in here?
Yeah, it's easier if you go around the back. So go to the right and then around to this building. And then there's a stairwell to the basement on the other side. That's a little bit easier to get to. Yeah, and then go to the right of where you are, one more building, sorry.
And as we navigate, how do you divvy up the work? And while you're trying to make campus as close to reality as possible, how do you all agree amongst yourselves on new additions to add?
So we have right now basically an Excel or Google Docs spreadsheet that everyone writes their name in terms of the things that they're working on and would like to see others sort of do. And that's just a way to sort of say, oh, I'm working on this if anyone would like to join. We also have a large group chat that allows people to join in and say, hey, here's the things that I'm thinking of. Anyone else have ideas? And often it's a good way to encourage people to join in on some of the building. But yeah, I think that stairwell should work. Or yeah, go directly forward. Or left, or not that one.
Wait, not this one? This one?
It might work, yeah. And then, wait, left side? Make a quick
Ellie, where are we going?
Okay. At the right of this building, there's a door. Right there. There you go. Right in that way. Wait, left. Turn left.
This one that I'm looking at?
Not quite. So if you turn a little bit left, so if you turn left, or turn 180 degrees. Okay, turn... There you go. That right in front of you, that door.
This one.
Yes.
There we go.
There you go.
Perfect.
Is Tim the Beaver anywhere on campus?
I think I saw something inside of the stud at one point. Yeah, and you went inside of there. So this is the Aero Astro sort of area. If you go to the basement, there's the machine shop that has been decently well built alongside some of the various people and students who are the ones who operate the machine shop, which I think is really cute. So if you're a Core 16, you'll recognize some of the names of the labs heads inside of there, which is really nice. And then naturally, pictures of this had to be sent to Dave and Drayla, and they were very amused by it.
And two detailed questions. Can you access this using a Nintendo Switch device? And is the Great Sale represented?
So you need the Java edition of Minecraft to join onto the server. We're right now also looking into making copies for non-Java editions. I don't think the Switch edition is the Java version, so I would
probably
recommend...
The Switch edition is the Bedrock edition, which is the similar one to the Windows 10 and Pocket edition, so it wouldn't be compatible with our server as it currently is, but we'll be looking out in the future for a compatible server copy.
And can you remind us one more time about how many students at this point are contributing to this project?
So there's roughly 200 plus who have asked for builder permission, and then there's about 1,000 who have people who have joined the server itself.
I think the figure is closer to around 300 now, especially since we had an uptick after finals happened and we started getting accounts for various MIT students from funding.
Great. And we're running out of time very quickly. This has been amazing. It's been so nice to have this be interactive. I hope everyone enjoyed it. So we're at the 2-minute warning. So after whatever you want to show us last, Shayna, we will end it out with Billy.
Yep. Anybody got any other requests?
Lots of thanks are coming through the chat. Someone called the wall geniuses. Everyone thinks this is fantastic. Someone said, let's do it again.
Yeah, I'm actually planning in the future to have a recorded longer tour of like my usual tour guide spiel, some commentary and like some special things on this, because I think as we've been doing the Q&A, I haven't been able to speak as much as I usually would on a tour. Yeah, so you come out on YouTube, so for people who maybe don't have the game or just like want to hear my little insider bits on it, was I've been recording the actual history of the project, and yeah, we've also been working with the MIT Museum in order to possibly like preserve this as one of their first like fully digital artifacts, as well as like a sort of unique artifact of this specific moment in time that it was created in. So yay for fun museum times.
That's a great idea. So while we're still observing the campus, Billy, why don't you close us out by telling the alumni how exactly they can get involved with this project?
Sure. Would you mind re-enabling screen sharing really quickly?
Absolutely. You should be all set, Billy.
Awesome.
You know, so can stop my share
really quickly. So first of all, if you go to minecrafttours.mit.edu in a browser, you'll face this wonderful website in which we have a couple of pictures of various things on top of there, as well as the overview map that you can see the larger extent of campus and so on. If you actually want to connect to the server itself to go and view, let me do a new share of Java. So you go inside of your Java edition right there, you click multiplayer, you can do direct connect, type in minecraft-tours.mit.edu. We'll do join server, and then you will, once it loads all up, I have my settings on super duper high to try to capture some images from earlier so you can see some clouds and likes of that. And then you'll be presented with the server, and that's how you go and connect.
Thank you so much. This was incredible. And thank you to the three of you for spending your Saturday morning with us and letting us experience being back on campus for this virtual reunion. We really appreciate it. And with that, we are going to close out today. Thank you so much, everyone, for attending. And thank you again to our panelists.
Thank you for joining us with this. Wow, there's been a lot of participants.
All right. Thank you, everyone. We're going to end the meeting now. Have a good day.
Thanks for joining us. And for more information on how to connect with the MIT Alumni Association, please visit our website.